So quantum computing, there's two aspects to it. One is a national security concern. A large enough quantum computer could break encryption. And so we use encryption for digital data, for our communications infrastructure. And if you can break that, that means that you can hack into people's emails, you can listen to digital conversations, and you can alter, we store all of our records in digital files, and that's how we use them as truth. And so now all of a sudden you could go through and change who owns properties, who owns stocks, all those kinds of things. So that's one aspect. The other one is that it's expected for the next 50 years that the economy will be powered by quantum. And so there's a global space space race to see who's going to be the leader for the next 50 years using this technology.
So here we have, in a literal sense, a public-private partnership at the table here today. Congressman, your take here is we hear from the Biden administration. I don't know if you saw this coming, but it seems that we're in a world with technologies like this and artificial intelligence where you both need each other right now.
Oh, absolutely. I think yeah, I think the government needs the private sector more than the other way around, but I think we want to make sure that we're supportive of their efforts and make sure, in part, that we stay out of the way, but also in part that we provide the type of capital and support that they need.
Stay out of the way
grow.
Or provide guardrails as well?
Well, I mean, it's a fine line, especially since most of us in the government, and I include myself in that category, don't know much about what they're actually doing. So when you get deep into the weeds, there's a reason I went to law school and didn't stay on the PhD track. This is one of those.
Okay.
But, you know, I think it's important for us to make sure that we're facilitating their growth and their development and research, because we are in competition with China and other countries to make sure that we can stay ahead of the curve on this front and also maximize the capabilities. As you heard, the military applications, the cybersecurity issues, and just the other research possibilities are all powerful reasons to do that.
Well, and part of that competition with China does reflect itself in things like exports controls, but arguably it also does in, say, legislation like the CHIPS Act, where the U.S. is trying to make more of this stuff on U.S. shores rather than having it be centered in places like China. Do you have a relationship with that kind of legislation? Do we need a quantum computing act realistically, or are these things actually intersected?
Some intersection, but we definitely need more investment by the U.S. government to go to quantum industries. If you look at China, they've allocated $15 billion. They've built a small city in China, which is just for quantum.
Right.
The five-year plan for China states that they will leapfrog the U.S. and the West by using quantum technologies. We haven't allocated that kind of money because it really is a public-private partnership. So the way we compete in the West is not just through government, but also through industry. And so we need to strengthen that relationship to be able to compete against countries like China.
I'd like to hear from you more, Peter, on cybersecurity, because what you said is important here, recalling the CrowdStrike event, the intense competition with Palo Alto, the questions that we have, and kind of like you mentioned, Congressman, falling into the arms of these companies with technologies that we don't always understand. If quantum computing can crack cyber defenses, can it also enhance cybersecurity if used properly?
Yes, it's both the problem and also the solution. So we're working on, and others are working on, quantum networks. And these quantum networks then can't be hacked by quantum computers. So it's both the problem and also
hopefully
the solution.
So that's the future of security.
Indeed it is.
It like, kind of reminds me, a diamond is the only thing that can cut another diamond kind
like
of situation.
Hey.
I'm just trying to think of a way to analyze this in my head. So as we talk about the idea that this may be, have important implications for national security, cybersecurity, you obviously think a public-private partnership is very important. Is this also bipartisan? We know that competition with China is maybe one of the few things that you and your colleagues can agree on Capitol Hill.
Every now and then there are one of those that pop up. This, I think, is one of those. I think the challenge, though, is really going to come down to the allocation of funds. And my Republican colleagues, as you may have heard, are, you know, trying to move these sort of funding issues in a different direction. Overall, But I think even here, we can find bipartisan
support. So the ability for the U.S. to be competitive in quantum computing could be completely related to the spending fight that's about to go down when you return to the Hill
in a few days? I'll say it this way. I mean, as you just heard, you've got nations that are actually trying to poach U.S. companies and get them to move there that are in this field. And at the same time, you've got a gigantic investment by China in the computing field, the quantum computing field. So if we want to stay competitive and stay ahead of the curve, which allows us to deal with some of the other factors you were talking about, like export controls. If we're behind, we don't have to worry about export controls. We're trying to catch up.
Yeah.
We're still in the lead, and we can maintain that, but it's going to take, I think, a joint effort. We've left out academia as well. Mm-hmm. There's the third corner of the Iron Triangle, but if all of us work together in a coordinated way like we should, I think we can maintain our supremacy.
This is about education, though, it sounds like. You guys are on a roadshow to tell people what we're talking about. We can't get through a day without hearing about AI. Is quantum computing a blind spot in Washington?
I mean, I think AI is such a broad umbrella. There are blind spots under that rubric, too.
Understood.
Because sometimes people are talking about different things. But at the end of the day, I think Congress needs to focus, and we need to do it by committee because, you know, not everything's going to fall under every category. Deep fakes, for example, that's one committee, but doesn't necessarily go to these kinds of issues and challenges. The military applications, we haven't even talked about drones yet. But I think, you know, we need to make sure we're moving forward on all of those fronts in a way that allows the scientists to take the lead and with support from the government and academia.
Peter, you want to talk about drones? Yeah.
Well, it's just these new quantum networks. We're working on quantum computing and also quantum networking. Within quantum, there's another area, which is quantum sensing, new ways to be able to image into the ground, oil exploration and those things. We're doing two out of the three. Quantum networks, one of the places to be able to build a quantum network to a drone. And then the neat thing about that is you can't hack the communication to the drone. So if you were in Ukraine, there's no way to block the communication between the drone and the ground. And so it's maybe a really powerful way to be able to control things on the battlefield.